You're watching Tag TV. You're watching Tag TV.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with Afghanistan, where the security situation is rapidly deteriorating as the Islamic State and the Taliban continue with their killing spree. The insurgent groups are taking deep, diabolic strikes into civilian areas and have been successful in pushing the security establishment on the back foot. Scores have been killed and many have suffered grievous injuries in the latest round of violence that has gained intensity, especially after the launch of spring offensive by Taliban only a few days back. A report.
Mayhem unleashed in the city of Jalalabad in Afghanistan as four Islamic State terrorists armed with machine guns and rocket-propelled grenades barged into a government building, detonating multiple bombs that killed at least 15 people and left dozens severely injured. The attack that followed, a coordinated design, was the latest in a series of attacks that have ripped the country in the last few days. The attacks have particularly gained momentum after the dates for the much-delayed elections that are now scheduled to be held in October were announced. Scores have died in severely deadly attacks since last fortnight.
Bridgar o lumdai motorbam chaudana wakda lumdrabam chaudani urusta bridgar de masupe daridna na shewidi alta de amne tsla kun le lori parir de qat sara de duitela manzurul la para amaliat pel shewidi.
Ever since the spring offensive was launched by the Afghan Taliban, the dreaded organization has ramped up its devious operations in a bid to gain more control of the territory. The Talibanis, fighting to restore their version of strict Islamic law to Afghanistan, have repeatedly said that their campaign was a response to a more aggressive US military strategy adopted last year, which aims to force the militants into peace talks. Although they have repeatedly affirmed in the past that they would never hurt civilians, their action speaks otherwise as they head towards capturing more civilian territories. An amateur video shot by a local exposed their ambitions of controlling more territory. Estimates of the Taliban territorial control vary, but the Pentagon estimates that 56% of the country is under government control, while a BBC survey this year estimated that the insurgents were active in almost 70% of Afghanistan. Afghanistan has also become poised to violence and terror as multiple forces are at work to halt the democratic exercise of elections. Many a time, election centers have been attacked by the insurgents. Experts across the globe also believe that the political infighting to grasp power is also one of the prime reasons for the Taliban rapidly gaining control over the large areas of the country. Ghani's overtures for a peace process by offering an unprecedented deal to Taliban didn't pay off, as the insurgents called it a design of cheat and conspiracy.
Taliban said it was a conspiracy orchestrated by the foreign occupiers to enervate, crush and eventually pacify the ongoing legitimate Afghan resistance. Moving on, Pakistan has a poor human rights record as it has been treating its citizens with brutal force. The incidents of enforced disappearances, torture and murder of activists and intellectuals are common. Persecution at the hands of state and non-state actors continues. The latest targets are the journalists and social media activists. We have a report.
Human rights defenders in Pakistan are under threat from a targeted campaign of digital attacks, which has seen social media accounts hacked and computers and mobile phones infected with spyware. In its report titled Human Rights Under Surveillance, Digital Threats Against Human Rights Defenders in Pakistan, Immensity revealed how attackers are using fake identities and social media profiles to ensnare Pakistani human rights defenders and mark them out for surveillance and cybercrime.
We uncovered an elaborate network of attackers who are using sophisticated and sinister methods to target human rights activists. Attackers use cleverly designed fake profiles to lure activists and then attack their electronic devices with spyware, exposing them to surveillance and fraud, and even compromising their physical safety.
Bashir Naveed, a Pakistan-born human rights activist who now lives in Hong Kong, reveals malicious designs of Pakistan to target its own people.
They have now Cyber Act of 2014. Which does not allow anybody, even on social media, to interact with each other. One UK-based organization is saying that there are many, that military has established a surveillance, that they monitor every this chatting of the WhatsApp and other thing. Now you can imagine that WhatsApp, it is always said that it is encrypted, but in Pakistan it is not.
The activists are being subjected to threats, intimidation, violent attacks and enforced disappearances. They include journalists, bloggers, peaceful protesters and other mainstays of civil society.
Disappearances is very much common, and whoever dissent from the government, so that is must that he should be or she should be disappeared. But what we have only the limited information about the persons, how many persons are disappeared, because when they disappear any person, then they force the family. If you tell, then you can find that dead body of your son, brother or husband or sister like this. So this is very common.
In an estimate, there are 70,000 reported cases of enforced disappearances in Pakistan. In Balochistan, where pro-freedom movement is going on among the ethnic Baloch, people have been kidnapped and tortured before being released. Some have never returned. Interestingly, Pakistan's security forces fail to act against terrorist organizations who freely organize events in main cities.
Terrorists and religious parties are on the streets, and they do this very quickly, very easily, under the patronage of police and judiciary. Now, no such religious organization has ever been sentenced or victimized for that reason. They use the mosque loudspeaker, though there is a ban on mosque, on loudspeakers from the mosque, except for just calling the azan and other things. But really, those are actually, state is allowing these fundamentalist religious and terrorist organizations to do what state needs, to silencing the population.
In 2017, five bloggers were kidnapped allegedly by the country's spy agency for their views, which were published online and seemed as being too critical by the powerful army. They were charged with infamous blasphemy, a Pakistani law that can mean the death penalty for those seen as insulting Islam or the Muslim prophet Muhammad. It is not only bloggers. Implicating people carrying dissenting views with blasphemy charges has become part of a pattern in Pakistan. State and its institution are often blamed for this.
The Human Rights Commission of Pakistan says that country has failed to make progress on several issues, ranging from enforced disappearances to women's rights and protection of religious minorities. Moving on, people of Pakistan-occupied Kashmir are protesting against Pakistan both at home and abroad. The latest rounds of protest relate to the fifth death anniversary of Arif Shahid, a Kashmiri nationalist who was assassinated at the behest of the Pakistan Army and the Inter-Services Intelligence on 13th May 2013. People of the region who believe they have been treated unfairly for seven decades have sought an independent judicial inquiry into the matter. A report.
Follow
Several nationalist parties in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir took to the streets to demand justice for Arif Shahid, a well-known Kashmiri activist who was reportedly assassinated in Rawalpindi on 13th May 2013. Shahid was critical of Pakistan for its illegal occupation of the territory and other human rights abuses. In Rawalpindi city, a large number of people gathered to pay obeisance to the Kashmiri leader. They criticized the satanic coalition of inter-services intelligence and political masters of Islamabad for marginalizing the region and treating its people as second-class citizens.
हमारे लिए ये बिल्कुल अनूठी बात थी कि कोई टारगेट किलिंग कर देगा कोई टारगेट करके मार देगा लेकिन उस वक्त शायद हम उस तरीके से रिएक्ट ना कर सके और जिसकी वजह से इनको हौसला मिला और उसका नतीजा ये हुआ कि वही जो नामालूम कुवते थी वही जो खलाई मखलूक थी उसने जहां इस पुलिस को इस्तेमाल करके वही काम करने की कोशिश की और नाते और पुरामन शहरियों पे गोली चला के एक और नौजवान जिसको मैं शहीद दूम कहूंगा शहीद अमन कहूंगा नहीं पर को गोली मारी
आरफ शायद शहीद के कातिलों को
गिरफ्तार करो
आरफ शायद शहीद के कातिलों को
गिरफ्तार करो
द जम्मू कश्मीर नेशनल इंडिपेंडेंस अलायंस An umbrella alliance of Kashmiri political parties and civil society based in United Kingdom also organized a protest outside the Pakistan consulate in Bradford and raised slogans against Pakistan for denying justice to Shahid. In London, a large number of Kashmiri activists gathered outside the Pakistani High Commission and demanded justice for Arif Shahid and other political leaders killed in POK. They shouted slogans accusing ISI and Pakistan forces for the murder of Arif Shahid. However, cynical, they demanded a fair investigation to be headed by a high court.
पूरे पांच साल गुजर गए हैं 13 मई 2013 को हमारे महबूब कायद जनाब आरिफ शाहिद साहब को घर के बाहर गोलियां मार के शहीद किया गया था आज तक उनकी एफआईआर पे कोई इन्वेस्टिगेशन नहीं हुई है उनके कातिलों को गिरफ्तार नहीं किया गया है और स्टेट की तरफ से किसी किस्म की कोई दादरसी जो आरिफ शाहिद साहब की फैमिली है या आरिफ शाहिद साहब के जो फॉलोअर्स हैं उनकी नहीं की गई है और हम ये महसूस करते हैं कि आरिफ शाहिद साहब की शहादत के पीछे उन ताकतवर लोगों का उन खुफिया लोगों का हाथ है जो पाकिस्तान की रियासत के अंदर सिविल और पॉलिटिकल हुकूमत से ज़्यादा ताकतवर हैं और वो अपना नाम छुपाए रखने के लिए किसी भी किस्म की इन्वेस्टिगेशन की इजाज़त नहीं दे रहे हम ये मुतालबा करते हैं कि एक जुडिशल इंक्वायरी हाई कोर्ट के जज की निगरानी में एक जुडिशल इंक्वायरी की जाए
इट इज़ नॉट जस्ट आरिफ शाहिद But Islamabad too has mastered the art of eliminating activists and leaders voicing their independent opinion. Its army is accused of arbitrary detentions, enforced disappearances and extrajudicial killings. History is testimony to the fact that anyone daring to speak against the barbarity of the army meets the same fate.
Pakistan Army has used extreme high-handedness in order to suppress the voice of the civilians of the region. Moving on, as the holy month of Ramadan begins, Rohingya refugees who have been living under the dire humanitarian conditions in Cox's Bazar for months now are finding it increasingly hard to procure food to perform their religious rituals. The situation of food crisis has persisted since the beginning of the mass exodus as the life-saving assistance provided by the international community, including United Nations, has not just been enough for the refugees. A report.
Wow.
when Muslims around the world are gripped with fever and festivities of the holiest month of the Islamic almanac Ramadan, people in the refugee camps of Cox's Bazar are battling for their daily food and essentials for the religious customs. A sense of fervor could be felt in the camps, however, there are no senses of celebration owing to the acute shortage of food and the other belongings. For refugees like Imtiaz Fatima, who had a tough time living in the precarious conditions of the camps, this month of Ramadan has become a period of uncertainty and melancholy. Living in tough conditions, most of the refugees reside in flimsy bamboo and plastic structures. Fatima reflects on her life in Myanmar, where they were able to work and buy a delectable spread for their families. Today, refugees are finding it hard to make their ends meet, let alone celebration during the ninth and the holiest month in the Islamic calendar, which is usually marked by fasting and visiting friends. Fatima cannot forget the horrific scenes when she was forced to leave the country. She grows grim as she narrates a happy and fulfilling past, unlike today, where she is living a life of suffering and despair. An assessment carried out by United Nations World Food Programme and Food Security Sector partners in last month of 2017 by interviewing thousands of refugees revealed that there was a massive shortage of food and other essentials in the camps. Although hundreds of thousands of food vouchers were being provided to the refugees on a daily basis, a complete success has not been achieved to date.
Around a million of Rohingya refugees are living in these shelters. Myanmar government has been claiming its willingness for a smooth repatriation. However, the reality is that people have still not found a congenial atmosphere to live in. Moving on to Nepal, where an educational institute, Tansen Multiple Campus, has provided a ray of hope to the disabled people of the district of Palpa and the region around it. The institute, which got completed with an aid and assistance from neighboring India, not only aims at dispensing a quality education to the section of society which has remained deprived and marginalized for longer period of time, but also nurturing them into professionally employable citizens. A report.
A collaborative endeavor of both India and Nepal governments is yielding results as the Tansen Multiple Campus, an integrated institute to educate and build the handicapped of the Nepalese society into professional force, is thriving. India, which has been Nepal's economic, social and cultural friend for years, provided a sum of 15.4 million rupees for the construction of Palpa headquarters of Tansen Institute. Equipped with the latest technology and state-of-the-art gadgets, this educational academy has been training more than 1,000 impaired students turn into professionals. The institute offers a divergent range of courses, starting from the fundamental teachings to post-graduation courses. Campus chief is highly grateful to the government of India, which gave an economic assistance to the institute when it was going through infrastructural crisis in order to accommodate more pupils.
47 सालमा यो पाल्पा जिल्लाकै पहिलो सामुदायिक क्याम्पसको रूपमा यो क्याम्पस स्थापना भएको थियो लामो समयदेखि विद्यार्थीको चापहरू हामी कहाँ भइरहेको थियो तर हामी आफ्नो भवनको अभावमा विभिन्न ठाउँहरूमा स्कुलमा भाडामा लिएर कहिले कहाँ सर्दै कहिले कहाँ सर्दै भौतारिरहेका थियौँ। यसै सन्दर्भमा हामीलाई भारतीय सहयोगमा यस किसिमको शिक्षाहरू प्रदान गर्ने संस्थाहरूलाई सहयोग हुन्छ भन्ने जानकारीमा आयो र हामी आफ्नो योजना लिएर हामी त्यहाँ गयौँ। गइसकेपछि हामी योजनामा पर्न सफल भयौँ।
An estimated 500 students have completed their post-graduation courses from the college and now serving the society. The institution has witnessed a rapid inflow of students in recent history and is planning to grow more. Shyam Nupane, a post-graduate and now an alumnus of the college, expressed his gratitude to the Indian government and specifically mentioned the infrastructure that came from New Delhi's help.
यो भवन जुन भारतीय राजदूतावासबाट को सहयोगमा निर्मित भयो होइन, यसले चाहिँ हामी जस्तो दृष्टिबिन्दहरूलाई चाहिँ सहजता नै भएको छ। विशेष गरी हामी त दृष्टिबिन छौँ, तर पनि जस हिन्डुल गर्नको लागि यहाँ रेलिङहरूको पनि व्यवस्था छ होइन, रेलिङहरू पनि बनेको छ। अनि यो विशेष गरी यो संरचनाको हिसाबबाट सिडीहरू छ, तसर्थ हिँड्नलाई चाहिँ खासै समस्या चाहिँ छैन।
This institute has proved to be a blessing to the challenged people of Palpa who were living a life of despair and disparity. Now they not only feel inclusive and mainstreamed but have nurtured wings of ambition which will certainly be realized with support and guidance of the institute. The institution can also prove to be another milestone in the deepening of ties between India and Nepal, whose trajectory is heading north owing to combined efforts of both.
India and Nepal have committed to engage at multiple social, economic and political fronts to take their relationship to newer heights. Moving on. Hundreds of millions of Muslims started fasting from sunrise to sunset as the holy month of Ramadan commenced. The month of Ramadan, which is believed to be a time of contemplation, fortitude and intense worship, also brings cheers as festivities grip the atmosphere. The festival was welcomed with pompous and gaiety in South Asia. A report.
Hundreds of people congregated to attend grand iftar feast in Bhopal city of India as the month of Ramadan set off. The largest democracy of the world, India, has been epitome of inclusiveness in diversity where people of all faiths have been practicing their religion with all freedom. Muslim around the country will be fasting every day for a month, refraining from eating, drinking and smoking from sunrise to sunset. It is a month of self-discipline and empathy for those living in poverty. As one of the five pillars of Islam, fasting during Ramadan is accompanied by increased spiritual reflection, worship and acts of charity. In another city of South Asia, people thronged the market of Kabul to purchase the traditional foods to be consumed during the fast-breaking iftar meal during the holy month of Ramadan.
خریداری میکنیم به خاطر که ماه مبارک رمضان بهترین یک ماه است که ماه خیلی با فضیلت و خیلی با شکوف و با چیست.
The fasting month comes amid an upsurge in the violence in the country. The Taliban, which contest more territory in Afghanistan than at any time since it was driven from power by the US-led forces in 2001, has launched spring offensive to drive out the government and restore strict Islamic rule. Food stalls and snack shops across Pakistan were overflowing with customers buying samosas, pakoras and jalebis to eat after breaking their fast, the first day of Ramadan in the country. Traditional food at iftar varies from country to country and in Pakistan the meal is not complete without snacks like pakoras, samosas and jalebis.
Ronak hai pure markaz mein ronak hai, main yahi pe rehta hu Al Mustafa Towers mein, to kafi ronak lag rahi hai aur yahi ronak ronkon ka mahina hai yaar, to zahir si baat hai ye Ramzan एक महीना साल में एक ही दफा आता है और साल में रौनक एक महीने में ही चलती रहती है।
With a population of about 208 million people, Pakistan is the sixth most populous country in the world and has the second largest Muslim population after Indonesia. About 97% of Pakistanis are Muslims.
The month of Ramadan culminates with Eid al-Fitr, the end of the fasting period and also a festival of fanfare, visiting and generosity. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Take care and goodbye.
You're watching Tech TV. You're watching Tech TV.